Now we'll see what is inheritance. So, by definition, inheritance is a mechanism to provide the power of reusability and extendability. So, it facilitates reuse of the things which we have already defined, and it will also provide us the extendability by which we can extend the whatever things, existing things we have, we can extend that. So inheritance is the process by which one object can acquire properties of another object. So say there is a class which is already defined, say box class, the example which we have seen. And if we want to define one more class which will have properties of this box class as well as some new properties which will be required for new applications, then what I'll do is I'll use the existing box class as well as I will add some member functions to it to define the new class. So this process is called as a inheritance. Now let us see all the important points which are related to inheritance. The capability of a class to derive properties and characteristics from another class is called inheritance. This is a bookish definition, but we can extract meaning very well over here, that derive properties and characteristics from other class and create a new class. This is what inheritance is. So inheritance is one of the most important feature of object-oriented programming. Now, as inheritance is introduced, there are some terms which are newly introduced here. The first term is derived class or subclass. So the class that inherits properties from other class is called a subclass or derived class. That means box is an old class already is there in the code, and I want to design a new class, and that new class will be called as the derived class. Okay. A base class or a super class, that means the class whose properties are inherited by the new class or a subclass, is called as a base class. So I'm giving you continuously the example of box class. So box is an older class which I'll be reusing. So that box class is called as a base class or a super class. Now, how reusability is supported by this feature? So when we want to create a new class and there is already a class that includes some of the code that we want, so we derive the contents of the old class as well as we add the contents of new class. So this supports the reusability. That means use the code which is already present instead of implementing the repeated things. Okay. So if we have a class which is name of the class is animal class, and this animal class has some variables and functions, okay, which can be used by all the animals in the world. Okay, so we can have domestic animals, we can have wild animals. Okay, but here generalized class I have declared as animal class. Now, if specifically I want one application for dogs, then what I'll do is in animal class there are some variables and functions which are already implemented for animals, but now I want to be specific. I want some features and properties or applications which are specific to dogs. So I will use this animal class as well as I will add some functionalities to this dog class, and then I will implement my code. Similarly, in this case, if I want to do it for cat applications, I will use this animal class as a base class and this cat class as a subclass or derived class, and I will reuse this animal class. This is one more example, cow class. In cow class, I will use feature of base class, that is animal, plus its own features. Okay, so this is the best example which can describe what inheritance is in programming languages. Now, let us take one more example. So, a parent class or a base class or a super class is a point class. Okay. This point will have a single point with coordinates x and y. We have declared x coordinate, y coordinate. Now, This base class can be derived by a new class which is called as a line class. Now this line class it is using all the functions and variables which are declared in the point class. So what I said, the point class is having x coordinate and y coordinate. So when I'm writing this derived class or a child class line, it will automatically have those two variables, x coordinate and y coordinate. Now what new thing I will need to add is, because one more xy coordinate will be needed and a draw line function will be needed, that I'll add over here, and the existing thing I will take from the super class. So this is how it is implemented in programming techniques. So let us discuss more about this inheritance. Suppose this base class is a student class. Okay, so this student class can have art students, commerce students and science students. Okay, so once with the student class, I have defined name, roll number, address, phone number. Okay, these are the 3-4 variables which are already defined in the base class, which is student class. But whenever I am saying art students, their subjects will be different, their marking scheme will be different, that I'll define in here. Okay, similarly, if I have commerce student, subject and marking schemes will be different, and for science student, the subject and marking scheme will be different. Okay, so this is what inheritance is. This is just an introduction for inheritance I am giving. It is a detailed unit we have for study. The next concept is polymorphism. Now, what the word polymorphism means? The ability to make more than one form. Okay, a single thing is used for multiple purposes. Okay, remember this line. A single thing is used for multiple purposes. How? That we'll see. So polymorphism means that the same thing can exist in more than one forms. Okay, polymorphism is in short the ability to call different function by just using one type of function called. Suppose let us see example, then we'll see this diagram elaborates more about polymorphism. This plus sign is used for what? Normally in programming language, we use this plus sign to add integer, floating point, double type of numbers. Okay, so this is the purpose. So here 5 plus 9 is showing the purpose of plus sign. But now I want to use this plus sign to concatenate the string also. So string concatenation is not the basic function of plus sign in mathematics, what we have learned. But we will program in such a way that this sign, when the numbers are passed to this plus, it will work for addition of numbers. And when it is used in between two strings, it will concatenate that string. And when this plus is used for adding the branches, it will form the tree. When this plus sign is used with the boxes, it will attach the boxes with each other. So this one single plus sign, but it is performing multiple type of task. Okay, but how we enable this functionality, that is a main thing. Okay, but we should know first what a polymorphism is, then we'll see how to implement it. First you must understand that a single thing. So here I'm giving example of plus sign. So instead of this plus sign, we can have a function name add. Add function, when two parameters are passed which are integer, it will add two numbers. When I am passing two strings, it will concatenate. When I am passing parameter of two boxes, then it will attach these two boxes. When I am passing branches to it, it will form the tree. Okay, so this is about the sign, and the same thing can be implemented for function. Let us see one example here in main program. Sum1 equal to sum, and into bracket I am passing two integer parameter, 20 and 30 to it. So it is calling this function, the left hand side, integer a, integer b, it is adding two integers and returning. So normally if this kind of function is written, it works for it and we are done with it. But if this I am implementing a polymorphism in that case. Allow me, object oriented programming, allow me to call the same function with three parameters. So I have to define that integer sum. When it is having three parameters, you have to add three numbers. So this sum 2 will equal to sum of three integers. So here a, b, c, three integers are passed, and I am returning value of addition of all three. So this is polymorphism. A name is same, but performance is different, and this performance is decided depending upon what parameters I am passing to it. Okay, so this is what a basic of polymorphism is. Remember this word, ability to take more than one form. Okay, now the C++ supports two types of polymorphism: operator overloading and function overloading. So as I have given you one example of plus sign, that is operator overloading, and the example which I have given as say sum function, it is function overloading. So the process of making an operator to exhibit different behaviors in different instances is known as operator overloading. Let us go to the example. This is operator overloading. The plus is an operator, and I am using it for multiple functions. Next is a function overloading, in which function overloading is using a single function name to perform different types of tasks. Now normally such type of things are not allowed in a C language or whatever languages we have learned before, but in object oriented programming it is allowed. So this is what polymorphism basic is. Now after polymorphism we have next topic as dynamic binding. So whenever this word dynamic comes, that means it is runtime. Okay, binding means attaching something. So runtime, whenever we are attaching or binding something, it is dynamic binding or runtime binding. So dynamic binding is the process of linking of code associated with the procedure call at runtime. So there are times like compile time, runtime. So compile time is a time when we convert the source language to the object code which is readable by computer. So during that compile time, if some processes are performed, those are compile time. But when I am submitting this object code to the machine for running, at that time some decisions are take place, and that is called as a runtime. So in dynamic binding, code to be executed in response to the function call is decided at runtime. So at compile time, it is not known that which code need to be run. Okay, so at runtime, this decision take place, and C++ has a virtual function to support this. So again, there is a new term introduced, that is virtual functions, and it is called as a runtime decision or dynamic binding. One more term is there, it is called as a message passing. The process of invoking an operation on an object is called as a message passing. Means what? In response to message, the corresponding method is executed in the object. So when two objects are created, so how they communicate? In the form of messages. So object communicates with one another by sending and receiving information to each other. So how to send and receive this information? A message for an object is a request of execution of a procedure, and therefore will invoke a function in the receiving object that guarantees, that generates the desired result. So that means how these messages are passed? By executing the procedure. We have class A, in that A function is written, and we have class B where B function is written. Now these two classes want to communicate. How they will communicate? They will communicate through calling of functions of each other. This is called as a message passing. Now let us see this diagram. Here we have student object, then we have faculty object, then we have management object. Okay, so three objects are having different types of variables, different type of functions. So here this circle indicates a list of variables, and square, this rectangle indicates the number of functions. Now the student object and faculty object are communicating by the messages. Now how these messages are sent? From the function of faculty to the from the function of one of the function of faculty is invoking a message towards the student. Now what this message is? Performance. Okay, so for performance, this faculty is accessing the student and getting the information. That means through the function of faculty, I am accessing information of a student. Similarly, this management is accessing faculty information for faculty's performance. Okay, now if the student wish to check the result, then student will invoke this request with the help of a result call which is stored over here. So this is how the messages are passed from one object to other object for various applications. This is what a message passing is. Okay, so right now we are just discussing the basic concepts. Now how these concepts are implemented in C++, that we are going to see with the help of example and in the environment directly, that how to write the code, how to run it. Okay.